Take two. Hello, you malty. Yes, malt mechanoids. Ralphie here with Whisky Review 431, and thank you to Kevin Top for that malt mention. This is the second take. I started recording just a few minutes ago, but I mucked up the malt mention. No good. Not nicey. So here we are. That's the reason the whiskey's actually poured in this whisky review. And here it is. Caol Ila 25-year-old. Oh, big age statement on this whisky. Old stuff, more expensive stuff. What are we getting? Are we getting much more of a whisky because it's older years, as you know? Because we've been kind of networking a wee bit for a little while, malt mates. You know that the longer a spirit spends in the cask, the more maturation happens. It doesn't matter on the size of the cask or how often the cask has been used, something happens. It may be not a lot, it can be quite a lot. You never really know until you actually smell and taste. And what I'm doing is sharing this malt moment with you, just an opinion, as you know, and the whole idea is to encourage you to have more confidence and have more assertiveness in what you find from the whisky so that you can make your decisions rather than relying on other people making decisions for you. That's important. How about the nose? No splishy splashy, a gentle roll in the glass builds up the aroma to go up our nose. Age, smell of age, those classic notes. Polish, leather, slightly chocolatey, slightly fusty that you tend to get with older casks. Perfectly natural, no harm in that. In fact, it smells quite delightful. It's worth saying at this stage that this Caol Ila is bottled at 43%, so it is not a cask strength single malt. But fortunately, they haven't taken it down to the legal minimum of 40%. That's reassuring, certainly helpful. It is, of course, an official bottling. And there's something you need to know about aged official bottlings, but I'll complete this review first, then I'll tell you about that. Interesting stuff. Complex. Old leather. Fragrant. Quite sweet. Peat. White port. Getting the texture of white port in the nose. Vanilla, plenty of vanilla. Vanilla oil, vanilla cream, vanilla wood, vanilla pod. That's what it is, not vanilla wood. Incidentally, one thing you need to know about vanilla, which not a lot of people know, in fact, a vanilla is part of the orchid family. It's a creeping orchid, and it is quite literally the only commercially useful part of any orchid apart from its flowers, and that's the vanilla pod. Someday I'll tell you the Latin name and you can go and find out for yourself. Back to the nose. Almond oil, red bark honey, the Australian honey, poached pears. And if I was to add a drop of water, we'd get some more floral notes. Lily, good example. Noticed, by the way, here's the teaspoon, but we're not using the teaspoon actually, we're using the straw. At 43%, this single malt is remarkably fragile with water. I've already added too much in a previous tasting, so I know now just a single drop of water is all this whisky needs. If you decide not to add any water at all, you wouldn't be going far wrong. What we do find with the addition of water, we're changing the ratio of alcohol to the water that's already in the whisky. So we're kind of weakening the influence of the alcohol slightly and chasing off those flavours. The nose fruities up, it softens a little bit. The peat becomes just a little more gentle and languid. Flavour-wise, remember in your first sip, malt mates, less is more. Mild, growing intensity. So it starts mild, creamy, slightly vanilla honey. But then you get this steady crescendo of just quite robust peatiness, mineral peat, some seaweed, that coastal marine nature that you get with Caol Ila, even though the whiskey is no longer matured on the island of Islay. You need to know that it's matured near Perth at a place called Blackgrange, great big huge industrial complex. Soft peat arrival in the development, old Muscovado rum, very reminiscent of some of the Guyanan rums that I've tried over the years. And a rich, quite a rich graininess, but that slightly salty mineral note, that seaweed nature constantly re-exerting itself over the malted barley. Polish, furniture polish. I have to quantify this and say I do not actually spend much time tasting furniture polish, but this is just simply the perception I'm getting of this. The age on the nose transfers very eloquently through on the palate as well, particularly in the development in towards the finish. And the finish, there is that leaf fire. You know, when you're in the autumn time, when you gather the leaves up in the garden and the twigs are in there and they're still slightly damp, but you light the fire anyway and it's terribly smoky. You're getting a little bit of that in the palate. And in the finish, we've got those tea, strong English breakfast tea notes, a little bit of jasmine tea, lavender, interestingly enough, some vanilla oil and avocado oil. I'm finding the avocado oil. Sometimes it's there, sometimes it's not. It's just the way it happens. Malt marks, here we go. In case you're wondering what this is, before I started recording, I had to relight the lamp up there because it had run out of lamp oil. And of course, like the complete numbnut ninny that I am, I've left this lying about, getting in the way of this splendid single malt. Will I ever learn? That's out of the way now. We can concentrate on this whisky review. 88 out of 100. That is, yep, you guessed it, a malt mark. Wonderful. Anything else you need to know? Some words of wisdom and transcript of my erstwhile experience and commitment, perseverance over the years. Well, yes, there is actually. This is an official bottling. You've got an option, malt mates. Wherever you are in the world, your availability to single malts will vary. In America, you've got quite a wide range of choice, but for some malts, you just can't get hold of them. If you happen to be in Australia, you have got a relatively narrow range of malts and they're all pretty expensive. So you may be interested in kind of comparing official bottlings of aged whiskies with independent bottlings, like Signatory bottlings and Cadenhead bottlings and Gordon MacPhail bottlings, good examples, by the Brothers and Rudd, another example. And what you will find is that in official bottlings, they're looking to maintain the house style. Quite important to the official bottlers is that they have continuity of experience, whereas in independent bottlings, you can get more variations, more themes going, depending on the individual casks or small batching of groups of casks. So something I would like you to kind of be aware of and be comfortable with, that you will find as you continue your journey with single malt whiskey and even some rums as well, that official bottlings will be quite engineered. They will be quite rigorous in maintaining an experience which they wish to attach to the branding, the label and the marketing. So in the instance of this Caol Ila 25-year-old, you've got quite a strong impact of age and old casks. But the fact that it's been reduced to 43%, the fact that it has been quite a lot of casks put together to get this range of flavours that fulfil the Caol Ila portfolio of flavours, you're finding that you can't add much water to it, and that the engineered nature of this single malt is quite specific in terms of smell and taste. I'll leave it at that. It's really open to your individual interpretation. But within the independent bottlings, if you were to see a 25-year-old Caol Ila, for starters, it's probably cheaper. Secondly, depending on the size of cask that 25-year-old whisky has been in over its 25 years, you may get a relatively young whisky, quite an old whisky, quite a spirit-heavy whisky, quite a cask-heavy whisky. There's more of a risk with independent bottlings because you don't have this continuity that you have in official bottlings. But at the same time, there can be the most delightful surprises. There can be a few disappointments along the way. The challenge is, as it always has been, to do your homework. By all means, read the reviews, listen to the experts, come and see the videos by crusty old anoraks like myself. You know, but at the end of the day, it's your decision. Do your groundwork so that you don't end up disappointed by a whisky that you thought you should be expected to buy and you did buy, but you realise in hindsight you shouldn't have bothered buying. These things happen, and I want to help you avoid that situation. I'm Ralphie. We have now concluded another whisky review here in the Manx Bothy, in that little diamond-shaped island that floats in the middle of the Irish Sea. Lovely place to be, as long as the weather isn't too bad. Anyway, I hope you'll join me again, where after I have completed this lovely whisky, it is a decent whisky, I have one more whisky to review. It's going to be a re-review of this 12-year-old Caol Ila, one of the most available Caol Ilas out there. I hope you'll join me for Whisky Review 432. You know it's not that far away. And I look forward to spending a little bit more of a quality moment with this so I can share my experiences with you. Isn't life wonderful? See you soon.